meeting here tonight. This is the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association. We're sponsoring this meeting with Joanne Campbell and Valley CDC so they can talk about their project for the lumber yard. Did I mention I'm the new president? There's the former president right there. And I'm the new president, got elected 2 weeks ago. I'm really excited about it. And anyway, so we're going to have Joanne's going to, and the architect, where's the book?
I'm right here.
They're going to do a presentation on what the project's going to could look like. And that this is an opportunity to put out suggestions, concerns. And so they're here to get your input. And so, Joanne.
Thank you. Thanks for coming tonight. I'm Joanne Campbell, and I'm the executive director of Valley CDC. We are located right here at 30 Market Street, around the corner. We've been in Northampton for about 25 years, and we serve the communities of Northampton, Amherst, East Hampton, and Hadley. And we do a number of things around Hampton County. Tonight, we are introducing our design and development team, and besides myself, I have Lee Nguyen here, who's our assistant project manager at Valley. Cliff Bomer of Davis for Architects. He is a principal at the firm out of Somerville, and he is the principal architect on this project. We also have Michael DePasquale, who is working with Davis Square, lives in Northampton, has had affiliation with Davis Square for many years. We have Molly Babies from Walter Kudnahupski Associates, landscape architects, who are working with us on the design. We are using David Bloomberg, who's a local real estate attorney with Pierce Cam Bloomberg, who's not here tonight. And then we have, we've used MDL Housing Development of Amherst for our housing consulting work, and we have Tony Lucas, principal, Jerry Johnson, and Abby Prezvolosky. So we're going to move to the next slide. So Valley is a local nonprofit. We develop affordable housing, among other things. We've developed about 180 units of housing over 25 years. We also provide small business assistance. We do home buyer workshop for first-time home buyers. We do individual homeownership counseling for first-time home buyers as well as for existing homeowners. And we also provide foreclosure prevention counseling. In our development and design goals, we have developed, as many groups have over the years, to be focused on sustainability and accessibility to a variety of folks and abilities. We try to connect to the community in our developments. We hope that our developments are positive additives to neighborhood character. And on this particular project, we're hoping that we align with the city's and the community's vision for this redevelopment of Lower Pleasant Street. Sort of why is housing development important to us? Our mission is to provide high quality, safe, decent housing for a variety of people across a variety of income streams. Why this site? Valley consistently looks for projects to develop, and just like a private for-profit developer, it's sort of what's available when you're shopping. And back in early 2013, after we had gotten site plan approval and funding for a 38-year family development in East Hampton, we started looking through the property, and the lumber yard was on the market, and we were able to get site control from the owner of the property. Why are we interested in this site? It's a great site located near downtown, close to public transportation, bike path. The Amtrak platform that's going to be coming in, the European bus station, and it's obviously a site that we can redevelop. It's an infill site, it's no longer being used, and so we hope that this will be a new addition to the Lower Pleasant Street neighborhood. I'm going to have Cliff Bomer talk about his firm, and I should say that we did do a request for proposal for architects. We do like to usually work with local architects, but we felt that this site had a number of challenges, and we felt we needed to broaden our scope, and so we interviewed about 5 architectural firms and David Sterling. We're happy to have them.
Well, I'm happy to be here. I'm Cliff Palmer. I'm one of the principals at David Square Architects. We're a medium-sized firm, about 32 people. This year, we're celebrating our 30th anniversary of primarily building multi-family housing. That's what we specialized in. For many years, primarily in Massachusetts, lots of different scales of multi-family housing. This is right in our mid-range of the types of developments we do. I think what's really kept us motivated for all these years has been exactly this kind of engagement of making sure that we're really soliciting lots of feedback on our development. Most of our work is publicly funded, so there are very high standards that we have to hold to as far as housing that's really durable, lasts a long time, enhances neighborhoods. Most of our housing, as this is an example, is funded with under very competitive funding guidelines, which are and the standards get higher and higher every year. So most affordable housing developments do not mean that they're very affordable to build. They're actually very expensive to build because it's housing that's built to last a long time. That's what we're trying to do here. I think we have special challenges here. I'll cover these first, but these are just some examples of a variety of different types of housing that we have done. We are specialists in sustainable design. We've been doing that a very long time. I think 13 of our staff are LEED accredited architects. We write the sustainable standards for the state of Massachusetts as part of housing and community development, as well as their accessibility standards. So we've worked across the state looking at all of the different types of housing developments that are proposed. And it's a really good way to learn about how it's done throughout the Commonwealth. These are just some examples. One up on the right hand is an age restricted development in Chelmsford. This project here that looks very sort of residential, small scale, and it's actually one of our densest developments we've ever done. It's 40 units on 7/10 of an acre in Belmont. These are some other little more urban setting. I think the project is probably the most similar to this one in a lot of ways. You'll see when you see some of the renderings of the Bloomfield Gardens. That's a development that's a smart growth site, just like this one is. It's in Fields Corner in Boston. It's a similar materials that we're proposing on this building, as you'll see a little bit, where we have a masonry base and some very nice metal panels on top. This is a development in Somerville that is visible right off of 93. When you're driving in, you lost a highly sustainable project, PV panels, planted roof, mixed-use building, as is essential for proposing here. And here's the site. So I think all of you know the site very well. These are the different views of it. Right now, the site is pretty much 100% paved, fully impervious. Surfaces. It's had, as you know, until recently, a very active commercial use with a lot of truck traffic and trains people driving in and out of the site quite a bit. It was unfallowed for a few years. There is one existing historic building on the site that's in pretty bad shape, which is this guy back here. It's an older building back behind the showroom for the lumberyard that is out on Pleasant Street. This is the view from Holyoke Street. These are the lumber supply houses. And in order for us to achieve our goals, we do have to remove this piece, the building behind, and of course the lumber sheds.
some of the existing context. I think you all know that by the time you get far enough out of town, heading south on Pleasant Street, the neighborhood changes quite a bit as far as architecturally speaking. There have been a lot of buildings that have been taken down in the lexicon of the city. A lot of anomaly buildings were put up in place, buildings that are taken down historically. And you see a lot of spaces that are developed between the buildings as you go further south on Pleasant Street. Our site is pretty interesting in the sense that it has very little frontage on Pleasant Street, and then wraps around and has a little more frontage back on Holyoke Street. We'll talk a little bit about some of the zoning. Well, here we are right here. So Central Business District zoning is relatively new to overlay, and it's a aggressive zoning with lots of goals related to activating the streets and a lot of pedestrian activity on the streets and generally providing mixed-use buildings, so commercial or, as they say, non-residential use on the first floor, residences up above. And as you can see, these are zoning requirements that are very urban in nature, zero side setback, zero rear setback. The front is preferably right on the sidewalk, but you can be within 5 feet before you need additional special permitting further than 5 feet from the sidewalk. So generally, zoning that is really talking about filling out the sites to the perimeter is really what the guidelines are looking for. The maximum building height is pretty high in this district. It's 70 feet. In fact, there's a minimum height of 30 feet in this part of the town. Probably the most interesting point from, I think, that is really behind the idea of activating the streets is the requirement of commercial use. It's now residential use on the abutting the sidewalks of the site, and it has to be a minimum of 20 feet deep. The desire is to really create activity, to have viable commercial users in those spaces on the sidewalk. There's absolutely no parking requirement. New buildings that are constructed in this district, there's no parking requirement either for the commercial use or for the residential use. And finally, the way that the city wants to have a strong say in following the guidelines or working within the guidelines, and I don't know how many of you have seen them, but there's a pretty extensive pamphlet on the design guidelines. There is a Central Business District Architectural Committee that reviews the design for the buildings that are proposed, or the developments in general that are proposed to be built within this district. This is our proposed first floor and site plan. I guess I'll start out by saying you can see a lot of images, some of which look very much like complete buildings. I think it's really important to point out we're actually very early in the design phase of the tectonics of the building. The parts that we're developing now, as is normal in a design process, is getting the site plan well worked out, and a lot of the technical issues that are associated with locating the building to this scale on that site. So as I was noting before, we have a requirement in this district to have frontage on wherever we have street frontage, we have that commercial use and non-residential use. What we're proposing, this is Holyoke Street on this side, Pleasant Street on this side. This is the Great Paint Shop to the north. This is the optical store there, and this is the law firm in this building. This is a little gable-ended brick building. This is an anomaly building with a mansard roof, and I think you all know what the break team looks like, a commercial rolling front doors. So what we are proposing to do, we always should point out one thing. We also front end Short Street. Short Street isn't a public street. Short Street is a private street. So we have no deeded access, and whatever access we may have historically had, we've lost because of shutting the access off through the occupancy of those lumber sheds. So on this street, we have no rights for vehicles at this time. So what we're proposing is a development of 55 units right now. We're looking at between 50 and 60 units. Right now, these plans are showing 55 residential units, and we'll break down a little bit later. At this Holyoke Street, Valley CDC wants to move their offices too. So they'll occupy this space. They're attached to their space is a community room that they want to dedicate both to their own use within the CDC, but also make it available to the community for public use, and that will have its own entry off of Pleasant Street. I'm sorry, off on the other street. Pleasant Street, our approach on Pleasant Street is we're pulling the new building back from the historic building. You probably know now that the showroom for the lumber yard now is butted right up against Amy's building, the law office. We're pulling that back away, that both as an effort to enhance the facade and to enhance the appreciation of that building, but also to provide our primary pedestrian entry for the residents of the building. So the way the building is organized then is commercial space this end, commercial space that end, and then this bar on the first level is the start of the residential apartments. It would be raised up off the street to give a little bit of separation for the units that are located on the first floor. They'll have their own entry. The first floor units all have their own entry as well as access to the corridor system in the building. The parking is organized both along the railroad tracks. I should point that out. I'm sorry, the railroad tracks are all one way. You probably all know that anyway. So the parking is organized against the railroad tracks and then wraps around parallel to the Short Street. What we're proposing as a way to engage Short Street is to provide I guess I would call this semi-public space, landscape, open to any pedestrians coming in, both residents and non-residents, who might want to use this space for passive recreation. It also happens to have practical use for a turnaround at this end. The landscape, Molly Bees is here tonight. She's our landscape architect. We're working on the landscape plan that will be part of our submission for the review of the architectural committee. So as I've said some of this already, but putting numbers to it, we have 41 parking spaces, which as I pointed out, there's no requirement for any parking, but we're building an apartment building. We want to have parking spaces for that, and so we're maintaining a ratio of 0.75 parking spaces per unit for the residential units. We're very close to downtown, and we're confident that that's a viable scene for a number of parking spaces. I didn't point out the building will have its own laundry facilities within the building. The community space I did mention that will be available for use by the community. We have a lot of sustainable standards that we're going to meet. You probably know Northampton has subscribed to the energy code, the stretch code in the state of Massachusetts, which is very high standards for sustainability. So the building will be built to meet those standards, and actually will be built beyond those standards. We probably will have a third-party certification as well. We're mentioning Energy Star here. We have lots of bike parking. I didn't point that out. The site plan, we're accommodating one space per apartment unit for parking, for bicycle parking. So we're looking at between 50 and 60 bicycle parking spaces on the site as well. Here's our unit breakdown, primarily twos and threes, which is in demand. It's also, it also aligns with the state guidelines that will be providing funding for the development. But we still have 14 one-bedroom units, and the remainder are family units. And Joanne, maybe you want to talk about the income levels?
So where all the units will be affordable, and with the funding sources that we'll be using, the majority of the units will be affordable to households earning between 50 and 60% of the area median income. And what that means is people will basically be earning between $30,000 and $50,000 a year. $30,000 for a single person and $52,000 for a family of four. We will be applying for rental subsidy, which would then allow family households, not one bedroom units, to be able to serve very low income households at 30% or less of the median income, which is about $26,000 for a family of four.
From here on out, we'll see some images of where we are with the design of the building. I think the important principles that we're using are following the business district guidelines as far as selecting materials, commercial space, a lot of glazing down to lower levels. What you're seeing in this image, so we're looking south, this building sits exactly where the road takes a curve to the right, so it's very prominent. Location as you're driving out of town. And what we're trying to do is really concentrate the precious materials in the places that they have the most impact. So we're proposing to use a significant amount of masonry and brickwork on the primary facade of the building on Pleasant Street. As I said, lots of commercial exposure onto the street, which will, we hope, bring a lot of light to the street, help enhance what's starting to happen at that end of Pleasant Street. It's typically a four-story building. The area right at the corner there, we're bringing up a little bit higher to give it a little more prominence. I think the overall height right at this point is about 54 feet. That's where we're at, to the top of the parapet. The parapet is there, again, to enhance the visibility of the building, but also provide an area where we can put some mechanical equipment behind there and screen it so it's not seen from the street at this point. That's looking from the other direction. Now, when you're coming up from the south on Pleasant Street, actually, it's a break tank that has the straight-on view but you see the corner of our building. We're proposing back to a certain distance on this elevation to use panels, metal panels, architectural panels from this point forward. And then in the remainder of the building, you'll see the Holyoke Street view in a second. The remainder of the building, we're looking at using a cementitious clapboard material for the first three stories and a cementitious panel material at the attic level of the building, i.e. the fourth story of the building. The idea, as you saw from your footprint and from the images, it's a long building, so we're using elements to break up the massing of the building. This is the view down Holyoke Street. We're proposing to use also masonry into the entry on Holyoke Street, which is the CDC's entry, and the public entry to the community space will be from over on this side of the building. Again, these are the cementitious panel materials and clapboard materials down below. Colors, we were way far from determining that. So, view these colors as placeholders. This is a view across the street on Pleasant Street. What we're really trying to convey here are a couple of things. One is that this is the entry into the residential entry. So, to pull it away, you can just see the edge of the adjacent brick building. We pulled our building back, and the residents of the building who arrive by foot will walk through this little entry court to go back to their entry lobby.
What is that actual?
It's 15 feet. Then this is our commercial entry. We don't have a tenant designated at this point. I can't tell you who will be in there, but we have a commercial space that greatly exceeds the requirements of it. District, at least the dimension of that square footage. This is a view back around. This is a view from Holyoke Street, so this is the entry into the Valley CDC. We're proposing to bring the brick material back there as well, that facade, and then a commercial storefront type of entry into the CDC. We picked this kind of evening view on purpose. Some call it an early morning view. I think it's an evening view. So, there's some obvious questions on the side there. But really, the idea is to get a lot of light out onto the street, have lots of transparency into that first level of the building, and really liven up that sidewalk. As you know right now, particularly on Holyoke Street, you come out from under the underpass, it's pretty grim. There's a long walk across the street, it's a tow yard. And right along our side of the street is for Sudan and Columbia. These are some of the challenges of this site. So the challenges are opportunities. I will say that the town benefits greatly from these adaptations. Right now you may not know this, but there's a large conduit, stormwater conduit that runs right diagonally under the site from the northeast corner across, exiting the site near where the curb cut is for the existing lumberyard access. It was built in 1846 and it's really big, and there's a lot of stormwater that runs through that. It's difficult to imagine, and actually did run some development ideas that left the conduit exactly in place. What we're proposing in order to develop the way that we're suggesting now is we're relocating the conduit. So now it comes under the railroad tracks, sweeps to the left, goes under the parking that was going parallel to the right along the railroad tracks, and exits Holyoke Street to the east, and then connects up to the existing historic conduit out in Holyoke. It's deep too, so it's a big thing. So we're essentially modernizing several hundred feet of conduit. Maybe you can talk about the railroad, if you know more about the railroad than I do.
So because we're adjacent to the railroad, there's a couple of additional requirements. Some have to do with that the lumber yard was part of it was previously owned by the railroad, so that has specific requirements. and any property that abuts a railroad has specific requirements. So we've been in contact with the Department of Transportation, the Massachusetts, because they're going to be taking some ownership of the rail, as well as Pan Am, nobody owns it now, is going to retain some ownership rights. I don't know the exact how that's quite working, but because Pan Am operates the freight line and will continue to run the freight line when Amtrak comes in, we will need to really get their blessing on the site design, as well as the city can't issue a building permit, which is several years out, until the DOT signs off on that. So we weren't able to, not that we would want to, but it keeps us away from the railroad tracks, if the railroad can have access to the railroad bed as well in the future.
It looks like it kind of spreads out quite a ways, but this is actually a pretty aggressive schedule that you're looking at here. We're in our approvals phase right now, getting ready to submit for getting in front of the planning board and the district commission, architectural commission. So we hope to have those approvals in place in December of this year. That corresponds to the day when we want to do a pre-application process with the Department of Housing and Community Development. Development is the major funding source. There's a larger submission due in April. If we are lucky and get funded the first time at the EDC, which is unusual, but it happens, we would be able to get a construction start a year out. April of 2016. It is about a year-long project, so that we think the quickest that we could actually get this development occupied is going to be out in April 2017. So obviously these are very rough estimates, but realistic if we could get funded first round. DHCD can make up their mind whether they're going to do one or two rounds every year. Sometimes they do two rounds, which could mean that the next best case would be 6 months out from there or 9 months out from there. We just don't know at this point. The safest in the next round. Any other questions?
Yes.
And we're open for questions, and we can move back.
I'm the executive director of the collaborative partners on public schools.
Sure.
And we own the school that's right next to the property. Mm-hmm. The collaborative serves 36 member school districts, New Hampshire and Franklin County. So we provide a lot of services in special education for the hardest to reach children. So we have children in that building that butts the property. Which interestingly enough, skipped over in talking about what butts the property as well as issues you might have. So I figured that I think that would make sure on the table. The first one is Short Street. So the Short Street is a street that is used by the school. It's used for buses to bring kids in from 36 different member districts, which is out in the afternoon. And there may not be rights now, but you basically said you have no rights at this time. And we're concerned about what happens with that. And the second one I'm concerned with about the construction that's involved in that building next to the school. That said, totally in favor of the project. We're committed to the most at least in the Commonwealth, and we're committed to trying to have a further housing work. So we're totally in support, but we're very concerned about the impact on our energy work. We're especially concerned about the right now.
I think as far as the Short Street, and Jordy can speak to this, is that whether the owners who have rights to Short Street choose to do something differently to seek the street to be a public street, that might change whether we have access to the school. And then it would be Amy Royal, who owns the breaking building, with her two business partners. Was there another question?
That's what I wanted to talk about. So, and I apologize, and I mentioned that. I think that where our vision has been today, just imagining how this would get built, we're not imagining much impact on Shores Street, though we really have such limited access to as it is. That construction activities, we're not imagining a huge impact. We don't know where the services are coming in yet, so there are services on Short Street, but we don't know yet where, you know, where they're coming up, how they're short. They might be spread out through the three companies that we have. But in any construction activity that would happen on site would be hugely fenced off from Short Street. So there wouldn't be, we don't have any rights in delivering materials, coming in and out. It wouldn't happen, I don't think. That you see the footprint of the building, it's going to be a little tricky, the staging of the construction, it's going to be a little tricky, but it's going to be primarily that along the way. But we're not at that point yet. We haven't talked to any contractors yet. We will be soon, because as part of our funding application, we need to provide an accurate idea on the projects and costs and staging the project, figuring out how to
Other questions?
Yeah, I have one. Can you explain the contingencies around state funding?
So this is, and Tillman, who's a housing consultant, can chime in. So there are a number of funding sources that we will be going after. One is low income housing tax credits, which is a federal IRS program which awards credits to the states, and the Department of Housing and Community Development awards those credits based on the merits of a project. The state also has low-income housing tax credit program, so that would be another funding source as well. And then Department of Housing and Community Development, there's a funding directly from the state for a number of funding sources, depending on the type of development that you're planning. So there is a bond bill that Don is involved in, Don's a housing policy person. So the bonding is for at least funding is available for the next 4 years. I mean,
within the parameters set by the legislature, the governor decides how much he wants to spend from the capital budget. Every year, so you never know how much is available, but the programs that you use are already existing programs. There are a number of alphabetical programs.
So they exist currently. And then there's also local funding, the Community Preservation Act funds that we've applied for here. Penn College has an affordable housing fund that we will be going after, and then there's Community Development Block Grant funds that Northampton is in control of it and coming to this project as well.
We may also access some sustainable funding that comes and goes. Sometimes there are people who will support agencies that will support putting a PV array on the roof, for example. We're too far out for that kind of funding. Don't worry about it.
Dane had a question.
Yeah. If you don't get your funding in April, what does that do to the rest of your schedule?
Well, the first
specifically about buying the property.
Buying the property, I was just saying. When we get site plan approval, we're dealing with the seller, who's been very generous in time with us. If we receive site plan approval, we will be purchasing the property from Gale Barnes on the lumber yard. And we have an approved acquisition loan through another affordable housing lender called CDAC that provides pre-development funds, which we have already have an award of, and that's we're paying third-party expenses like the architect, civil engineering. We've done environmental reviews at the site, so we have a loan for that, and we also have an approved acquisition loan to purchase the property contingent upon site plan approval. So we would, if we were approved in February, it would take us a couple of months, we would be purchasing the property sometime, let's say April or May.
And without that?
We take a risk then. I mean, the site plan approval, I mean, that's a contingency in the purchase and sale agreement. But it's not contingent upon getting funding for the project. It's contingent upon site plan approval, because we're fairly confident that if we get site plan approval, we will eventually be funded by the state. Yes.
Will some of the apartments be set aside for rentals?
They're all rentals.
Oh, they're all rentals.
I'm sorry, but it's all rental.
Obviously, you're trying to do so much on a too small footprint, but since this is largely for family housing, is there anything you can do in this open space to have playground equipment for the people that live there, also the school there? You know, I see there are a couple of kind of open spaces, with a little pocket kind of playground or something. You know, the kids that are going to live here, they have the closest playground to them would be home here, so they're crossing the line here, or they'd be crossing Pleasant Street to go to Pleasant Park. So, it would be nice to be able to go to
Pleasant Park. We see them all here, landscape architects. We haven't developed that, and we're certainly happy to hear suggestions about it. So, Molly, do you want to kind of talk about?
I'll say just a few words. We've just been working on this a little bit recently, and we've got some ideas about ways in which I'm a particular proponent of natural playgrounds, naturalized playgrounds, and given the city's interest in retaining as much stormwater on site, the idea of having a rain garden that could also be, you know, using some boulders and stuff like that for kids to climb on, to play in, and using that as a play feature. I've been thinking about the area.
Do you want to
go up
and
help?
No.
Yeah.
People could hear you.
Right. And so, if there were some kind of drainage down along here in the area, in this vicinity, being a rain garden play area, but additionally, could there be some kind of a larger paved play area? Structures, you know, again, we're not there yet, but I think that that's a really natural place for both residents and neighborhood kids to have access. There's not a lot of room for play for older kids, and that's one of the things I was wondering about is, you know, if there are older children here, preteens or whatever, could be at least a basketball hoop or something like that.
Mention the basketball hoop, because I'm always interested in what people think, because when people say teenagers, keep them away. But
I say get their energy out.
Exactly.
So, but I'm basically here to listen, because I am just starting on this topic now and coming in to look at what few spaces we've got. But, you know, basically this area in here and there's some courtyard there.
Perhaps the question is to figure out how to have more space. You might need to make the building smaller. Or fewer parking places. It's all a trade-off.
I'd like to figure out what the parking lot is going to have space.
And there's an entrance
from Pleasant Street.
There's some
here.
There's a rear entrance to the lobby that brings them out into that space. From the building. Not necessarily from the neighborhood.
So we want to build it as possible.
I should say that for the development of affordable housing, there's sort of a sweet spot of can't be too few units, and there's also a limit of how many units you can put in. So there's a purchase price of $1 million, which is the appraised value of the site. So that is the value, the market value of the property. And so with that price, you need to have a certain number of units to be able to make the cost reasonable. And then the numbers can get too high, so we're at the parapet, which is at 55 feet. I'm assuming the four-story building is 42 feet. The zoning allows us to go to 70 feet, so we could add more units, but that really doesn't make it work financially with the funding sources that are available. So there really is trying to match the number of units that make us competitive. The breakdown of the number of bedroom sizes also makes us competitive. If it's a family unit, we need to have at least 75% of the units have to be 2 and 3 bedroom units. Another requirement, 10% of the units have to be at least 3 bedroom units. So matching all these different requirements raise us to a number between 50 and 60 that makes it financially feasible to be competitive at the state level and have this be a good project in a downtown neighborhood.
So are there other ideas about the kinds of exterior uses or facilities that you think might be helpful to the neighborhood?
Can you just point out on there where the parking is and where the 60 bike racks are?
They're all the bike racks are all being still worked out, but we thought that there would be maybe a rack here. This plan shows them all along this mm-hmm. area. Okay. And then others usually go yeah, in this area.
And the parking and also with the
here. The parking, yeah, the parking wraps around.
Okay.
Are you in the landscape architect charge? Are you dealing with lighting or are you dealing with the overall lighting design?
Yeah,
civil and landscape. We have a civil engineer who's working primarily on the technical needs of the site.
Right, so they're not are they working on the design element of the lighting?
Yeah.
For instance, when the tech school was built, I think 15 years ago, more now. City mandated a ban in favor of certain historic looking light fixture. There are obviously a Joanna setting conversations with now there are city guidelines about what kind of light can similar to water, you know, enter onto kind of by the site. And some of that to be you know, some of it they want to guard against and some of it is actually good for the neighborhood. My name is Jordy Miller. I'm the building on George Street, which is the mill building there. And, you know, I certainly see an advantage in having a gentle, soft light illuminating from a residential area and, you know, and a well-landed parking area than having a monolithic wall and lumber yard. You know, likewise, I've been parking these close to the little restaurant across the street. And done well, it's much more interesting to them to see a sense of light there. But I'm just curious as to, you know, when that will become something to do some I have more things to think about or talk about, but since that was on the landscaping question.
So this is your parking lot right there, yeah. Right? Yeah. So you're going to be an important person for us to talk to because I think you've already expressed an interest that the lighting that we would provide for our parking might also share some light on your parking. And so we need to talk to you about that. We're developing that plan right now. Most of the guidelines in the town for lighting are trying to prevent against, you know, light pollution, the night sky. So, but I think we can come up with a typical metrics that can make you happy and work in our parking.
Yeah.
But it's in development right now.
Yeah, we can, I don't want to talk in this forum about how the actual construction impacts, you know, the actual pattern and impacts, you know, my tenants at the Herrick Mill. But as I said to Joanne before, the Hatch Academy building almost physically couldn't have been built without some kind of, you know, just common sense interactions, you know, with me on the site and Charlie Lyons, who built the building. We sat down and said, okay, what works for you? What works for me? What do you need? You know, here, you know, I don't think either of us want you to be dancing around the site and going and twisting yourself into knots and spending an extra $40 million because you can't step over the line. But we also want to make sure that it's, you know, not living misery. But, you know, that.
You heard that. You thought initially at this point that we wouldn't need to sail onto abutters' properties.
I don't think so. There's some issues with collecting that because it could make having, you know, planned access results to the thing. We'll have a little bit of issues. I mean, they're technical. These technical issues with the railroad right away because you probably know there's an existing retaining wall. It goes sort of halfway across the site that was actually the rear wall foundation for the lumber shed back there. But from there on forward, it's the Jersey barriers that are just sitting there. So we need a permanent solution, so we'll be building very, very close, like 18 inches, and we're looking at now that property. Mm-hmm.
We have a lot of neighbors to do a lot of work.
Yes.
Just a quick question. You just said building within 18 inches of the Jersey barrier?
No, sorry. We have to we're removing all the Jersey barriers. They're just sitting there sort of casually acting as retaining walls. We need to build a real retaining wall. So we're going to remove that, the Jersey barriers, that are really a temporary solution and never went away. And build a most likely a cast in place concrete retaining wall to provide a stable border for us.
I'm not familiar with lighting standards and requirements, but as you're speaking, I'm envisioning a soft, round sort of lighting area to complement the lights coming in off the commercial spaces.
Mm-hmm.
As opposed to garish lights that are 30 feet high or 20 feet high, yeah. The parking lot lights that we remember in the King Street district.
Yeah.
I don't know, is that what you had in mind? Or
we're,
maybe you can
absolutely
talk a bit to that.
I mean, our goal is to make this, I mean, a very attractive, inviting site. And that's both from a landscaping perspective and a lighting perspective. All the technical stuff we have to do, we have to do it right. You know, stormwater services, all that stuff. And we have all the guidelines that actually do support low lighting, you know, lighting levels as low as what provides safety, but also are attractive, not in the sky. I'm imagining, but we haven't designed it yet, but I'm imagining that we will have low lighting so that pathways are well lit, but we're not excessively lighting. And there are pretty strict guidelines about lighting that spreads over onto other people.
It'd be great to see as you learn. Thank you.
Just curious, in the beginning of your presentation, you mentioned how this project might fit into the larger plans of partnership. And I'd just be interested to hear more about that, and specifically, you know, at this part of Pleasant Street, near Short Street, for example, with a crosswalk that quite dangerous. And my understanding is that normally those traffic mitigation funds paid out for central business projects. But is there any intersection there? Is there any improvements that you could help the city accomplish that would benefit this project? And, you know, definitely safety, traffic safety along Pleasant Street. You have a few more cars coming in and out.
Well, yeah, quite a few. But I can tell you what we assume is carried in our development right now. The kind of bad news is Northampton did apply for MassWorks funding to provide a lot of new infrastructure along Pleasant Street, and they didn't succeed in getting that money, which would have been terrific because the larger part of the large goal of this building is to bring the kind of activity that's close to Main Street further down Pleasant Street, which is why we want a real active node there that will encourage similar and activating development from there up to the downtown area. And clearly having an improved pedestrian landscape to get there would have been killer, and that would have made it big. It doesn't mean that the city can't get that funding at some point in the future. So that would have solved a lot of problems, created a lot of more attractive development sites. Because as you know, there still are a number of parking lots that are completely open onto the street, and essentially some kind of inhospitable frontage on Pleasant Street in between our site and downtown. What we currently own, so to speak, is improving all of the public sidewalk and curb along our street carnage on Holyoke Street, and our neighbor has already done some improvements on Holyoke Street, so we'll connect into some of the improvements that have already been made on the other side of the curb cut for the optical shop. We have, unfortunately, a kind of absurd frontage on Pleasant Street. You wouldn't necessarily know it unless you looked at a survey, but our frontage is really limited, just this little spot right along there. We have an easement across the neighbor's
property, but we can't improve that, really.
So the breaking building now owned by Amy Royal and a couple of business partners, the property starts like this and then goes like this. And for all these years, the lumberyard has had a decent home, which is just from exactly where it is, but you have to go into the lumberyard property along that curb cut that's along Pleasant. And when we first were interested in the property, the planning department was very clear about that curb cut in the middle of the street would be eliminated, that that's a safety issue, and then as properties get developed, they want to reduce those kinds of curb cuts in the middle of streets.
And as you know, the Brady King building is pretty far back from the street, and unlimited no control cars coming and going across a very large curb set up in front of that building that has a garage door has to go. The city's goal is to bring that a very strong pedestrian defining line right down to the street and develop close to the street. So I guess the answer is I think we're doing as much as we can right now on the street frontage. Our bigger goal is providing an attractive destination to help bring more activity down the street. And it's clearly the goal of the business district is to increase commercial activity, activate the streets, better lighting on the streets, better security.
I wouldn't find a curriculum to infrastructure wasn't going to work.
But like I said, that mass works trend, and who knows, by the time we're actually building, it may be, they're going, they're 2 miles a year. But anyway, looking at our date, who knows?
Hi, I'm a long-term resident of the neighborhood, and I'd like to say that I think this is a great site for affordable housing, and I think there's a lot of very creative design thinking there, but I'm also in a bit of shock at the scale relative to the other buildings on Pleasant Street, and I was going to ask if you could go back with the slides and show, because, it seems that there's a lot. Most of the buildings around are 1, 2, or 3 stories, and this, especially, this. I mean, I appreciate the idea of using brick here, but this looks really dominant to me. It looks like it's really gonna really change the feeling of that particular church of Pleasant Street. And you said that this section up here. What's going on right up in this part right here? These are residents.
That's a terrace.
Yeah.
It's open space up there. And as I was saying, we actually used it to accentuate the prominence of the building. Talk about kind of the idea of it. But it's also just extremely mechanical. But because we have a lot of visible frontage, now we do. We've got a lot of visible frontage. We just want to make sure that I think your point, you're right. The scale is very different from a lot of the other buildings, but it's consistent with where the city really wants to go with sites. As sites open up, underutilized sites open up along Pleasant Street, they're talking about 70-foot tall buildings. We're far from that. We're proposing something that's kind of in the middle, almost literally in the middle of what's minimum height and maximum height. And nobody can predict the future. Nobody can predict the 2008 depression in the architecture business. We know what's where the city wants to go, and the city doesn't want buildings like that doing this part of the city. They really want a street, consistent street scape or a street facade. And I think it's just, we're early. We're early in the enactment, or the really the
playing out the new zoning. This is the vision of the city. I think the fairest thing to say is we're trying to plug into the vision of the city, not reading the vision. We're trying to live in that, within that vision.
We just want to mention that we don't have those pictures here, but we have done some wire scaling of what possibly could happen in 5 or 20 years when adjacent properties might change and how that affects what we're doing.
Well, that's a really good point, because it's hard kind of designed in something that you know is going to change so radically. And a lot of the are likely to change. I mean, this is a very prime location in Northampton. And we did a lot of studies that John is referring to, as we tried to look ahead to what it's going to be like when it gets built out. And, you know, assuming it does get built out, but we did lots of wireframe studies, buildings that could exist, but both that could be built out to fully built out to the what's allowed in the zoning and you know, different moderate solutions. We did some quick studies of what would work on other sites as well. So there's no question you're right. Right now it's very prominent, but we think it's going to fit in nicely as the city continues to develop.
Can we speak about the maintenance of the exterior? I'm not familiar with the terms that you used, and just, you know, what kind of maintenance will it require, and how many years, and
durability,
and how it will hold up.
Okay, that's a good point. You're talking about the building. I'll talk about the site as well. The building.
I can talk about property management as well.
Yeah, okay. Well, the building itself, I'll back up a little bit when I said earlier that affordable housing really isn't, when you're funded through the types of sources that we're using, is not cheap housing by any means. It's required that the buildings be very durable. So all of the materials have to be very durable. The buildings have to be well detailed. They're very expensive to build. So the materials that we're proposing are all very long-lasting, durable materials. The masonry, I think you know, the masonry requires pointing, every 40 years or so. You have to take care of masonry, even though it seems like permanent material, it actually does have to be maintained. That has a rather long maintenance cycle. Cementitious materials are extremely durable. They're literally materials that are...
You should ask me to define that for
the
layperson.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry. So imagine wooden clapboards. The modern version of wooden clapboards are materials that are shaped like clapboards, but they're made out of a cement-based material. They're heavy, it feels kind of like cement, but it looks like clapboards. So they're designed, installed properly. I mean, it's possible to kind of mess up anything, masonry or clapboards or anything. If installed properly, they don't have a limit on their useful life. There's like a lot of materials that are out there. Masonry can kind of last forever as long as you maintain it.
Is it painted or?
It depends. So, typically, there are different ways of, it is painted, which is great in the sense that we get a much greater variety of color of what the clapboards will look like. What we'll probably do is provide a factory applied finish, so they're painted in the factory, which extends the life of the paint job. And those of you who live in old homes like I do, we're not talking about a 5-year, 7-year painting cycle. This goes out much further than that, more like 15, 20-year painting cycle instead of a short cycle with wood. Similarly, the metal panels we're proposing, and I hope you can afford, are extremely high quality architectural grade panels that, again, don't have a defined useful life. As long as their seals are maintained, they last for as long as anybody in this room is going to be there, and longer.
I should just say for this party plan, which is a brand name on this cement wood fiber clapboard, is on the building in Flores that houses the Club and Top building. Do you know where Club and Top is?
The west.
Yeah, North Maple Street and North Main Street on the corner, the main intersection of Florence, is a three-story pale green building with two shops. So that is that kind of siding that was completed in 2005. So we don't expect that we need to change that for another 10 years or so. And then a newer building on King Street, 98 King Street, which is a deep red building, also has that kind of siding. So it looks very much like Clabber siding, but I think both times we had factory installed paint on those buildings. As far as general management is, we use Valley Seas, who doesn't manage its own properties, we outsource to professional management companies who maintain the properties for us, and I meet with property manager once a month, go over financials, go over issues at the building, so we would be hiring a professional management company that would be taking care of snow removal, landscaping, general cleanliness, and plus all the other tenants, rent up, rent collection, financial for the building. Yes.
I'm a bicyclist. And I appreciate the steps you've taken to encourage people to walk and ride bicycles. I'm just curious, with the 41 parking spaces in 55 units, how does that going to work? Because many households, as you know, have more than one car out there.
And then you have your commercial
spaces.
Right. So, again, what we have thought about, of course, you don't want to hear that there's no parking requirement, but there is no parking required in this area. But we did think, from the practical point of view, that it's an enhancement for tenants to have parking. Also, we don't want the people who do have cars to flow over into adjacent neighborhoods. Our rental developments, and I'm talking specifically about family developments, most folks don't have more than one car. I don't think anyone has more than one car. Again, we're hoping that because of the location, that there would be more biking, more walking, more public transportation, and that our goal had been to provide about 0.7 to 1 space per residential unit. And so this is where we're at the moment, is at 0.75 spaces per unit.
People won't be out there fighting for us?
Yeah, we haven't worked out the speed. I think one of the things we also think about is that people have choices about where they want to live.
Yeah.
And so somebody who might be a household that has 2-3 cars, this may not, they may choose not to live here because they can't accommodate their car situation. And so I was explaining after the business meeting at 5 that we have a number of SROs, single room occupancy units, in Northampton, and only one of our locations has parking there on 82 Bridge Street. And when people come in there, if they have a car, they might choose to live there instead of one of the others where there is no parking. So is it perfect? No. Have we been thoughtful about creating some level of parking that we think will be useful? Yes. Yes.
It sounds like the idea that the city may have had in mind about having commercial space on the first floor would be to draw more businesses, more activity, more folks wanting to come and maybe have a place to park and book to do their business. But also I'm wondering about visitors. I mean, somebody might come to visit the location on occasion, and that would create additional strain on the parking lot and overflow certainly in the neighborhoods. I don't know if the city had any plans to develop commercial parking spaces or new parking buildings with the design of having 70-foot high structures and envisioning where you're going to put the compounds. And I like the idea of having some open space on the property. I think that's very important for the overall atmosphere. I think if you had 30 units, maybe you could have 40 parking spaces and it would make sense. I don't know how those numbers work, but from purely the parking perspective, that would seem to be a better number. I don't know.
Yes.
it might be good for you to have more than five.
There's also, is there an elevator, is there,
there's no elevator in the building, there's certainly a one-step elevator, we have looked quickly at some biking regulations at other, some of the Portland, Oregon, Cambridge, some of them that have specific zoning around bikes, and Cambridge is one per unit. I don't think we would necessarily encourage people to bring bicycles into their units, not necessarily you can totally control it, just because it nicks walls and nicks hallways and
things.
Yep. So, I mean, that's, again, the question is, will every single person in the building, so if there's 100 people in the building, does each one of those folks have a bicycle? For folks who know who are big bikers, they have six bicycles. And somebody else has one bike or someone has one bike. So I, yes, I'm sorry.
I wonder if any traffic studies have been done. It's often standing traffic along that.
The city does not require a traffic study in central business. What I can say is this site was used as a lumber yard for many, many years with high traffic of trucks and contractors, and pedestrian use is a lower use than large vehicles. It's been quiet for 2 years now, so it sort of the neighborhood obviously has gotten very quiet.
I think that's a little skewed, someone who's been on that corner since 2001. I feel like you're portraying an abandoned property and no use for 2 years. And in fact, the lumber yard has very little traffic. I think you're sort of saying there's rigs in all the time, and contractors in all the time. It was a very quiet business. And people coming down Hollywood Street to go into Pleasant are often backed up 3 or 4 or 5 feet periodically during the day. And Pleasant Street is a creeping traffic, both in the morning and the evening. And I'm understanding you're saying it's not your responsibility to do anything about it. But we have some representatives here from the city. I hope you're hearing as a property owner on the corner of Hoyoke and Pleasant. I'm really concerned about additional traffic, and including for the residents, for the children who are going to be living in this housing unit, trying to get themselves into the bridge to school or downtown. That crosswalk is completely dangerous. Hoyoke Street is very narrow. There's not a sidewalk there. This private would put a sidewalk on the same side tropical studio, but across the street, the Harold's and Keller Williams, there's pavement right up to the street and no sidewalk at all. And I feel like if the city is thinking this is a great project, the city needs to rethink what we can do on Harold's Street. It can't stay the way it is from kind of 40, 60, 80 cars a day additional coming on that place. It won't work.
I was just wondering how the parking lots are monitored, or are they not, in terms of, like, if you're going to Roberto or the Convective, there's no parking, it's got a premium quality of parking in this parking lot, you know, walk to where I want to go, or the rail, or wherever you want to go, because you're dead, it's hard to find parking on that street. And it's easier also to park in a lot than it is on the street at the time, if you're so, you know, connected to the
meter. He expects that we would have parking stickers for our tenants. We haven't worked out exactly how that would work, but we haven't had the problem of having to tow cars from other developments, but I would think if that became a problem, there would be posted notices that only tenant parking only and cars would be towed, and not that I like to do that, but you know, that would be one option to resolve that problem. We don't expect to have parking for we don't know yet. I mean, there may be like one parking space for the commercial tenant. It might be a perk for the commercial tenant on the Pleasant Street side to have a space for the owner of the business. We haven't worked out those details yet.
How much commercial space do you have on Pleasant Street? What's the square footage?
I'm sorry?
The amount of commercial space on Pleasant Street. I know you say it was more than was required, but I was just wondering what.
We currently have about 1,500 square feet. And we floated between, I think we need a minimum of about 1,200 based on the frontage and the depth.
we require to have a little bit less than 1,200. Right now, and we haven't worked out all the details of the internal design, but right now, what we're showing is about 1,500 square feet of space with some storage that we don't know whose storage that is. From the commercial view, we have property management office, property management meeting room, up in that front section. Electric rental office management, fire protection. So we'll need, there's no basement in this building, so we need to create mechanical rooms internally in the building, and if you want a fire protection, the building will be sprinklered.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Okay. What kind of tenant are you imagining here?
You know what, I'm not good at imagining, in the sense that
maybe I'm being disingenuous. The way the space is being designed limits what can happen there, and limits it to becoming perilously close to either a very small precious retailer or office, because it doesn't allow for consistent delivery, it doesn't allow for trash in a cafe or a restaurant. It's a big leap to the city requirement that there be commercial activity there or something non-residential, as you said, inside us. It would be great to figure out how to have a bigger estate going there, you know, that complements, you know, the things that are trying to happen, holding on in the parking lot, and even those are not getting the kind of volume that they want. I think the city's goal is to establish, you know, magnet businesses there that will draw that kind of thing.
Well, we know what folks do, and the thing is, it's also it's a long-term plan, so it's hard to figure out who would be in there now. I can say when we bought the West Building, the building where Cup and Top is, we bought that in 2002. The woman who owns Cup and Top came to us in 2002 and said, I have a great business idea, I want that space. And she waited for a couple of years and developed a business plan and has been there now for 9 years. So anyone has any business ideas, we'd be happy to entertain those.
Well, it's a good point, and I think keeping in mind the schedule that you showed about the $6, we're really not going to finalize these fresh documents and where exactly that line is. We purposely left a really generous lobby space. We really don't know at this point. We're not going to start construction documents for a year.
No, but we've all been around the block, and we know that once the site plan is established, you've got to go back to the city to revise the site plan.
Well, actually not the
internal,
because
they're
not.
Right, but it would be
really
impact the building.
If it was a restaurant and had a good Ansel system or something, which I can say from the way the Ansel system looks and the prominence and not having a lot of space, that wouldn't be very attractive, and I'd probably shy away from putting that, because it would have to go on either on this side. Ansel is I don't know exactly explain it, the fire.
The fire department, but we also have to vent about 17 above the top of the building.
Yeah.
So if you have a stack, that would really not be convenient.
Over there, but
the whole kitchen.
Someone came to us and said we wanted to develop it while we were developing it and build it internally. That would be a tough sell to get that loaned up.
Thank you. Just to clarify for a second bite of the apple here, the Central Business Architecture Committee review will strictly be for what the building looks like. So the special permit site plan review for the planning board to address the kinds of things that the optical studio folks are concerned about, the way the site works. So the traffic issues, the pedestrian safety, the crosswalk, all those kinds of things, that would be better at the planning board for the site plan hearing. And any abutter within 200 feet would be notified. And then if you are outside of that radius, if you didn't go in for the gym, for the work, for the association, I'm sure everybody would
things on the common area. Versus the model here is taking it out stuff. So some of the buildings are more like you can all the way through, didn't find a parking space. We're going to be down there on the lower left by 5 trees. The space between the trees, is that pavement? Those trees drive around and get out?
Those trees are placeholders right now, and that's not necessarily what they're going to be. But one of the things we were talking about this afternoon actually was, I mean, all of that would be drivable pavement. It would be hopefully in a different texture or color or material than the parking lot that could be driven on, so there would be room enough for turn radius if that happens.
But we also have to figure out safety. We just students can back up into a space that we're using as a passive. So
then we have to put it up in bollards that are also low lights for that area that would be, you know, a buffer thing.
But we're thinking children would be playing.
Yeah.
So there would be a barrier there that would keep them.
But we've got a really small space there. Molly, you want to talk a little bit about this space in here that really we're seeing more as for tenant usage?
One of the things that I've noticed is that there are people who, you know, are crossing from Hoyle Road, you know, across the parking lot and out to Pleasant Street and all, and assume that this might be another sort of pass-through. So one of the challenges in designing this space is to have it be a place where people could be outside and living here. It's really sort of their place, but also people can move through pretty comfortably. So, you know, are there, one of the things we want to do is to make sure that we aggregate as much green space together, both for ease of maintenance and for infiltration of water, stormwater, and just for amenity, just being able to put more trees in there. So we're still, as we keep saying, we're still working in a pre-conceptual stage at this point, but thinking about if there would be enough little pockets for people to be seated in, enough open space for people to gather in, small groups to gather in, but also to have good traffic flow through it and protect the privacy of the residents on the bottom level along there. There's more to be said about that.
I think we're just thinking that people might find places, even though it's maybe private, that people will find a natural way, natural paths of the way people travel, and if somebody coming who lives in the Holyoke or Wing Street neighborhood might find that, oh, I'm going to get off of Pleasant Street, it's noisy, there's traffic, and might just decide to walk through the Holyoke. And so we were thinking, how can we create, remain, this area remain private, and how do we screen these apartments? And somehow maybe Molly had some designers who did it on here, to sort of that this might be a natural way to cut through the plot.
We can work with the width of paths, you know, to create a hierarchy of movement, so people moving through it understand what's sort of more public route and what are the access to more private areas. Hard to explain that without the drawing in front of me, but that's all.
I'm yes. Having a hard time envisioning why I wouldn't want to jump up Short Street and cut behind me through the parking lot.
Yeah, no, exactly.
Yeah, that's a bit of a challenge.
Yeah.
I mean, it is a challenge. I mean,
it's a challenge that, you know, in the way that every landscape architect talks about desire paths and that perhaps meaning the path that people will take regardless of where you've built the path. And in some ways, you shouldn't put the path down and build. If you've been there for a while, which is impractical, I understand that, you know, the case with the construction, but I mean, I think there's also an argument to be made for the fact that that is what people are going to do, and so why make it that they leap over berms and the property that's put, you know, lighted two-step stairways, you know, through, you know, the tiered parking lot to come all the way down from the old building to that parking lot, to the mill parking lot, to finally to the CDC parking lot, and call it what it is, which is a bunch of literally parking lots or something that you should get onto them and not make it, you know, look back to them.
I like what you said, Jim.
I mean, there are other things there where a little bit of green space along Short Street is depicted, you know, I think that what, you know, the people in the neighborhood are saying, I own the neighborhood, I live in the neighborhood for 15 years, I don't live in my building anymore. We have more green space for 10,000 square feet of commercial tenants, with residential tenants, than is exhibited on the other side of the street. I mean, when, you know, I, who knows, maybe it's just because I'm enough, or maybe it's because I was prefiguring the regulations, but we took up all the hardscape around the building, and it's all lawn around the building, lawn and flower gardens, and the whole band along Short Street there, actually, where it shows that it's open to the street, is mature lilacs that, you know, I planted with my dad 20 years ago, and now you've got mature lilacs that standing 20 feet high, and perfuming the street every May, but, so, I think there's a way to play into that sense of, in a positive way, in a forward-looking way, you know, creating that, you know, green oasis, like greener than oasis, which could be a real calling card, you know.
It's one of the dilemmas of the limited amount of space that's shown here, the limited. The challenge is to have as much green and open and pervious surface as possible. Also knowing that kids, especially young kids, really prefer playing on hard surfaces, you know, that it gives them more options. So, you know, I think it is trying to find a balance, and what our office has been doing is saying, okay, rather than having separate, you know, spots like this, let's bunch it all together, aggregate the green as much as possible, and aggregate the green areas in a way that's enclosed and protected for them, you know, for kids. So I think that that's, I hear what you're saying, and I recognize the challenge here. That's sort of the direction.
And I think the limits of the space are that, you know, we do need to have frontage on Holyoke Street, and we do have to have frontage on Pleasant, which brings the building out of when we first entered architects and people came with ideas about what to be on the site. Well, a number of architects pulled this building back. And it was very clear from the city that you feel like the Holyoke's not commercial street in the sense that there's a lot of activity for commercial activity. And so we really have to make that whole connection there.
Right. Can I talk about design?
Sure.
Or I suppose, that what do you want to say about
sure.
it?
Do you want us to move to a certain drawing? I just want to talk in
general. No, again, talking about things in the neighborhood, and you know, I'm not an architect, et cetera, but one of the reasons that I asked about the width of that space is 15 feet is from this wall to that table there. And at 15 feet against a 55-foot wall, we all know what happens if you get tall and narrow. You essentially have what shows up in perspective renderings that you're doing as an ample entryway, but it's actually a narrow corridor to feed back to the building there. The Royal building is 60 feet deep, so you've got something that's 15 feet wide and 60 feet long with 55 feet up the side of it.
We think it's actually going to be quite beautiful. It's we're imagining it as certainly it is an urban experience, and it's, I think we're pretty excited about the idea of taking advantage of exposing that side of Amy's building.
No, that's good.
And having that, which has been completely hidden, and it's quite beautiful, old brick. So I think we'll be walking along a historic brick wall on this side. We're imagining very nice lighting, as you can see. And once you're past the footprint of her building, then it opens up into a pretty sizable courtyard. So it's a little moment of compression that then opens up again outside the entry for the residents. And we're trying to keep a lot of transparency right through the lobby so that you feel the connectivity through that courtyard on this side, through the building to the courtyards that consolidated courtyard areas that Molly's been talking about. So I think we're seeing it as a very sensual kind of experience. So you're right, it is narrow, but you're walking by some really nice materials, well lit, inviting, and then coming on to a beautifully little landscape courtyard. So I think the unknowns of the future. In our courtyard, we have we're also going to have the back of Amy's building that is actually our building because they're still.
You own the wall.
We own the wall. So, just for folks, Amy Royal is. it was the old, what was it?
Eagles.
The Eagles building, thank you. There's maybe some other animal. And the lumberyard, and I believe there were fires, and but the building was taken down. The lumberyard took the building down. But the wall remains that abuts Amy Royal's building, and that building is intertwined in some ways with that building, so it can't be taken down, and so we will be responsible for repointing it, securing it, and hopefully making it a beautiful
And it is, it's visual. You can read the history of the previous building in that wall that's there, which is really interesting. And we haven't quite figured out how to carve the way. But, you know, it's a south-facing courtyard, so it'll be really full of sun for a good bit of the day. Amy's building will start to shade in the afternoon, our entry court. But I think it's going to be a really interesting space. We haven't worked out, and we're talking to Molly about it now, where are the fences, how big are the fences, what degree do we want to control the view within the development, so it's fully pleasant people walking through the residence there, and which degree do we want to keep it open. The city has expressed a pretty strong opinion about this being open. At one point we were talking about, well, it shouldn't be open because it's mainly for the residents.
Open in the sense that we thought we would have some sort of attractive gates or something that would show that it was a private entryway, and the city is asking for it to be open and inviting.
I think they were right about it. I think they were correct. I mean, it should be something that feels really wonderful to go back into. And we're not entirely sure where all the entries into the commercial space would be. Maybe there'll be an entry to the commercial space off the courtyard as well. But I appreciate your comment. It's mm-hmm. different. It is different.
As far as, and also, I'm here to exercise the conversation, not to be antagonistic, but I think the city felt the same thing about Hampton Court, which in principle presents, as open, but in practice has become not a place in, not anybody. All the people that were in the architect's rendering are sitting on the bench aren't there. Sometimes the town is on, sometimes it's not.
Right.
So it's a cautionary.
You can get to the office.
There's
a commercial space on the first floor there, I think.
Mm-hmm.
You can get
a what are the photovoltaics? How much of the roof line would have that, and how much power that supply?
Well, we haven't done the calculations yet, but what we have, as you can imagine, at this site, amazing exposure and a pretty big roof.
Mm-hmm.
So as long as we can succeed in really concentrating mechanical equipment, other penetrations of block shadows, which probably means largely in that area or over there, we have a really big roof area available.
So you anticipate using as much as possible?
Well, the funny thing about any of the these kinds of programs, whether it's solar hot water or PV systems, the funding for those goes all over the place. Right, if you did it today, you could probably get somebody who would agree to build as big a PV array as they could, and either sell us power at a predictable rate for the next 15 years, or sell it to the CDC. Right now is actually a pretty good time. It's just, I don't know where it's going to go. We're making the building solar ready. That's the way we're thinking of it now. We'll have proper phases to run whatever we need to run, whether it's water loops or our power lines down. We're making enough room in our electrical room to put the inverters in and the things that you need if you actually do implement that plan. We're structuring the room so we can hold it. We haven't at all thrown out the idea of a planted roof as well to help with the stormwater situation and slow down passing the stormwater and the storm sewer system. So it's kind of like everything else. It's a little bit of a balance in that. Whether you're talking about how much parking and open space and or creates an interesting puzzle for quite a while until you start moving and getting more specific. But we're just not there. If I had to say what, generally speaking, an array that would fit on a building like that would probably, you're talking about a system that would be feeding back into the grid, not all the time, obviously, but you would expect at least to cover at least the common uses, you know, the common electric uses in the building. It certainly isn't nowhere near being, you know, off the grid by putting an array. It's nowhere near that scale.
And do you plan on doing like on-off lighting or any kind of passive lighting?
Absolutely. Yeah. There would all be lighting by motion sensors. I think one of the challenges in this building is that we have a very long west facing facade. So your primary word is actually too much, not much coming in on the west side. So we've got the simplest ways to deal with that are coatings on the glass, changing the glass on the west side might be different from the glass on the east side. We tried in a lot of developments to create resa ledge structures that control the sunlight, but they're extremely difficult to do on a west facing elevation because the sun is down so low. We haven't engaged our mechanical engineers yet, but we'll certainly have a consultant who will help us run through different options, whether we're talking about thickening up walls or we're just not at that point yet.
And is the building air conditioned or not air conditioned?
That's a really good question. We've talked about that. I think it's probably likely it will be, but we haven't figured out what that system might be. I'm not even sure at this point we know who's paying for utilities. Do we know that now?
Yeah, I mean, ideally we would like to use the mini split system, which is an electric system. I'm not sure I'll explain it, but that would provide heat and air conditioning, those little heat pumps.
Well, that's a heat pump.
And they each need a condenser. Each of those units. So as we're talking about, I think I like the word that Cliff uses, just sort of a condenser farm up on the roof. It'll be hopefully behind the parapet.
Segregated up so they're not casting shadows.
And so if we were using that kind of a system, if the price works out, there would be air conditioning. I'm not a proponent of window air conditioners for many reasons. At this point, we would be going with that system, assuming we can price it, and then we can make decisions about whether people, whether there were sleeves and all that.
Right, and I think part of what's driving the way we're thinking about this is we're aware that there's a huge open that's not developed, anywhere near what can be developed in the previous district. So we're very aware of what buildings looks like from that elevation. There are a lot of people that come up and down Pleasant Street, and we want to make sure that the kind of decisions we make about mechanical systems are going to be consistent with maintaining a really attractive building. Again, you're a stretch of community too, so that it's highly likely we'll be modeling this building as we advance the design of the building and figuring out the optimal way to trade off how to build the walls versus more efficient mechanical equipment, or whether there's triple planes all the way around the building or just on the railroad track side. We're just not at that point yet.
So it sounds like it would be all electric?
It would be if it went to heat pump system, but I can't say right now.
You don't know without right, water, I think.
No, right now we're so distorted by how cheap gas is. Most really efficient buildings now use a lot of natural gas, and so cheap, but we have no way of knowing that that's going to be the case 2 years from now.
Yes.
Those of us who have been in the neighborhood for a while, been there over 60 years, kind of get used to the way things are, of course, and change is good, so, okay, there's a parking lot in a small building next door to this new building, and there's a few, the Great King, and that's a small building. Maybe not what I would choose to design today, but it's a small building. You talked about what the structures would look like overall. I'd like to, and you said you did some kind of imagining what it would look like, and maybe some drawings. I don't know if you have those with you, and
no,
to show them to us and speak to that and to the number of units, residential units, that might go into that section of Pleasant Street.
I don't know if the city's done that, actually. The city has looked at all the developable in quotes. I mean, people own these sites now and they're using them, presumably in the best way they can be using them right now. But, I don't know if the city's really looked at what happens if that whole district got built out to the standards that they put out there. The quick version of what it will look like if our neighboring properties were built out to the maximum is, and it radically changes. Maybe you could go to the street perspective. Well, this one most importantly, that as I said, we're at 54 feet to the top of there, but you can build up to this height there and right out to this line. We're not even at the property line. This building can come even closer to the street. So if that site were ever built out, just imagine a block that comes out like this and back around. Would anybody ever find that to be sensible to build to that degree? I have no idea. I don't know how it's going to keep evolving. Similarly, other parking lots up the street, parking lots that are open out on the Pleasant Street, they can develop similarly. I hope this building never goes away. I think it's a lovely little building. I don't know if it's the highest and best use for that site, but we did. I don't think it's any secret that we looked at studies of what could happen if we were able to acquire this site. How that would change, and it had a radical impact on how our building would be. It didn't work out that way. We tried. We tried to actually get more street frontage so that we could, as I pointed out, we've only got, it's not very many feet of street frontage. It's 135 feet or something of actual frontage. But you're asking a tough question. I just don't know. As I said before, we're trying to build what we think is responsibly within the guidelines that the city's laid out in their vision for the future. Who knows what a neighbor's going to do? There's a lot of space, as you know, on the optical store on to the south is actually quite an amazing site. Big, large, continuous space. It doesn't wrap around like ours does.
When we talk about, when we look at these buildings, if they became larger, it was really just a wire frame. It wasn't a building. I don't have the structure on the check.
Yeah.
It was sort of a band of wire, the open space, just to sort of show, okay, if this went to 70 feet and it went to the property line, and this building, and we use that in planning this building so that we don't, that if that did get built out, whether it was 5 years or 20 years or 30 years, that what would the impact be on our building and how much space is left for between buildings.
Mm-hmm. Which is why we, on our, the drain of our building that goes north-south, even though it's a double-loaded building, it's actually quite a bit narrower than most double-loaded buildings are. And we did that pulling away from the property lines. Because we don't know. Somebody could come along and build a zero setback.
We're talking about the one that runs parallel to the railroad,
right.
That long stretch. So the part that would face Pleasant Street, if you want to, I don't know if you can. We pulled it back a little bit so it's not.
Right here. So along this, theoretically, it's built out to the guidelines. There could be a building built right back to the property line. This dimension here is much narrower than most double-loaded buildings are, so we lost some efficiency, so to speak, by doing it that way, but we actually created some really nice units, skinnier units with more frontage. So I think it's good for the residents in the building, but it doesn't help the efficiency of the plan.
Double loaded means there's units on either side of a corridor.
Sorry. The central corridor, elevator fed central corridor. Once you're up on typical floors, the corridor goes most of the length of the building with apartments on both sides.
Yes,
Jerry. Joanne expressed to me that the dual arc curvilinear front on the building was somewhat driven by the way that the request and the amount of frontage that we had there. I can't help but thinking that vocabulary doesn't exist anywhere on Pleasant Street, doesn't exist anywhere on Main Street and on King Street. It does exist where it says car dealership. I guess I'm wondering what the possibility is of a vocabulary that expresses, that it's not in and of itself an honor, that says somebody with a less instructions around you, but that does reflect, the point of stationary block that just across from it, it does reflect the point of stationary block, at least the first block or two of Pleasant Street that come into it and try to maintain, obviously not slavish in any way the past, but to speak to that vocabulary and that sense of line and that treatment of
I hear
golden sills or
Well, let me say that we're still under development.
We did have a more rectangular.
I think what we tried to do with the first form, and I think the detailing of it and other reference lines that we can use and maybe bring into our elevation is still very much under study. The idea of the curved elevation, there are several reasons. What Mommy did want to put as much brick on the street as he could, and that was one way to do it, is to wind the building around. We also like the idea, because of that prominence of that view coming from the north, down Pleasant Street, we thought it is sitting right in the middle. We thought it was a nice way to make the transition around the building and down Pleasant Street. The rectilinear pieces we're picking up, and this really is under development, but with the sign band and the entry portion of the commercial space, the non-residential space, on the first level, it's still maintaining a more rectilinear approach. It is under development. I hear what you're saying. We really did look at a lot of different things, and from all the feedback that we got from the development team and others, that's where we landed at. We are far from having our brick facade detailed to the level of what we will be using, lintels, very well expressed sills, different courses of brick. We're not there, but we're headed there. I think that what you can expect at the very least, while the form may be new and different, we are really looking for ways of integrating a lot of the different ideas that exist through the way the windows are broken up. And the other central pieces of masonry building, so that what looks different about, masonry buildings aren't built now the way they were. Now masonry buildings are linear masonry. I don't mean Z-brick, but the quarter inch stuff. They're brick, all the historic brick in Northampton is brick that's really holding itself up. The structural walls are generally 3 or 4 wide. Thicknesses of brick thick at the bottom, sometimes you get narrower as you go up, but they're solid brick. This would not be a solid brick building. And it's part of what Joanne was talking about, like how come new buildings, the brick looks healthy? Well, it's because it's generally hung off the building. It's not holding anything up. There are angles that come out off the building and they sit on top of relieving angles. And so people generally don't detail it to the degree that they used to for very functional reasons. You know, lintels are stone beams because bricks don't stand in the way normally constructed. Soldier courses make small arches. We're not there yet. We just haven't gotten to that point where we're trying to weave together our goal is, and I know it doesn't look that way right now, but I can tell you that our goal is that was to kind of steal Amy's building, in a sense, like wrap her building into that composition, so that it speaks to that, making the entry more attractive, the entry court more attractive, and to get more street funding, so to help pull together a bigger piece along Pleasant Street to start to create a more coherent way of suggesting for development to people, I guess, if that makes sense.
Yes.
Okay.
Just we're approaching 9 o'clock, so I'm going to take one or two questions that I think if people have additional questions, they can call us or
yeah.
I would agree with Jory that if you look at the McCarthy building and the Keller Williams building, this building doesn't really echo any of the details or appearance of it. And to me, my first look at it is that another anomaly.
If you, to speak to this issue, if you look at the Strong Avenue building that was constructed maybe 12 years ago or so, right on the railroad tracks, brick facade, commercial down below, condos on top, I think that's what really matched the rest of the city in development. I don't know if you've seen that yet, but it kind of feels, wow, that really feels like Northampton. A continuation of Northampton. Not really a question, so I didn't take up the space.
And I think what Jordy's saying is if we had another anchor down on South Pleasant that looked more like up near Maine, you know, than the end of the future buildings in the next 50 years, would hopefully echo that as well. And it would look like they all in the same place. I'm really concerned about how the third looks for the size of it.
So I'd like to thank everybody for showing up tonight and giving your feedback. As I get the bat clean up here. So I like that you guys are talking to a butter. That I'd like that, you know, Jordy's been here and you guys have been in discussion. I'm going to suggest that the other butters also, maybe, you know, the collaborative and the optical studio along with Amy, you know, that maybe there is some sort of collaborative way to put the whole package together, because it does, if you look at the site, that there's a lot of things going on, and you know, maybe there's a way to bring them all together. I am echoing what Max said, and we heard at the earlier meeting from the Roberto's, people are concerned about the parking pressure that may occur here. You guys don't have to create parking. Thank you for creating parking. But that I think that there needs to be some sort of, from the city level, just looking at, you know, how are we going to accomplish this in terms of we're having people move in, they're bringing cars, they're going to have guests coming to their place. We want them to have guests. But there's also the businesses there that use the on-street parking both during the day and at night. And I think what would be really great is if we could all agree that intersection needs to be redone, that it's not a safe intersection, it's not well designed, that the traffic does get all backed up there, and part of that, you know, maybe it needs a signal at some point, maybe it needs some elaborate traffic calming design, but if we could all agree to work together on that, I think that'll help with the that whole area right there. So I'd like to thank everybody for coming tonight, and,
I have a note. I'm sorry.
Right, the council's bumping.
Just gonna say about my name.
Are you running for reelection in 20 minutes?
No, just very briefly, to that point, the city is, gonna soon undertake a full parking study of the downtown area, and so I fully expect this to be part of it, and I hope we get some good, hard facts and measurements and things that will help us.
Well, and the other thing I'd like is that this project is gonna take a while to develop, that we can have these discussions in the meantime around how to make these plans, so.
So my concern is we've always sort of said, yep, we're gonna have 60 units. That's sort of our starting place, and that seems like hard and fast, and that's part of the issue. When you say 60 units, you're already impacting parking, you're already impacting the schools, you're already impacting traffic.
And I encourage you to come to the Ward 3 Neighborhood Association and discuss this pattern. You're talking to the right person. But yeah, these are they're playing within the rules that we have established and we approve. And so that, you know, that we can change things by working with the city. And so if that those numbers. Yeah, there's a discussion.
I just also want to say, I mean, creating vibrancy in neighborhoods, noting the challenges that are there is that people have those children, households are one or two person households, so I think impacts on things like schools is a good impact. To bring more children into the school system.
This school.
Parking, traffic, the school. Oh, my God. Yeah, we do have to walk
and we're going to work on it. So thanks for coming, everybody.